were made tall every time it rained in the spots when it rained. I just don't know what else to do. I mean, I just think I'm not a person, and I really am not. And I work right here in town, and I just want somebody to be held responsible and for taking care of what needs to be done. I mean, only one time did I say, no, you can't come in. It was going to be a snowstorm, and I was leaving. I work 6 days a week. You come in any time. Monday's the only day I have off nowadays. But you can come in any time you want to do work. I just don't know what else to do. So you guys, coming here is very hard for me to do. Besides having a panic attack. I just really am at a loss. I don't understand why people can't, be held. I mean, I was growing up, you're held responsible for what? Your actions. You're told what to do, you do it. You follow through. We're not kids, we're adults. He's been told what to do. It's I don't think it's that hard. I mean, maybe I come from a different world. I mean, I don't know. I'm not a dumb person. I'm an educated person. And I was brought up by my dad, you know, even my father who, you know, Papa Bear, Mom, Baby Bear, has got, you know, said, and he has not even gotten responses to emails. Today I got an email saying that I was in the wrong. I'm not in the wrong. Yes, on social media, yes, to you guys, on Narberth page and everything, have expressed my feelings. I can't even have a holiday at my house because it's so cold. My kids can't even come. My daughters who are grown, your kids, my kids, are grown, can't even come and, they can't sit. You can't sit on the couch with your feet on the floor because that's how cold it is. It's 38 degrees. That's unacceptable to any law. Pennsylvania, so I got chastised because I looked up the laws. It's 60 degrees. That's 20 degrees, 30 degrees below what it's supposed to be. I mean, I'm sorry, but I need some kind of help or something. I don't know what else to do. I really don't. And this was my last way to go. And people were like saying, go, do it, do it, do it, do it. And just up until 5 minutes, I was like, not coming. So I put on my big girl pants and come. I'm sorry, that's, you know, and come because I have to.
So I'm going to ask.
I have the code inspector papers.
I understand all that. Okay. I don't know how long this meeting is going to run, but I think different members of council and the mayor would probably like an opportunity to have a conversation at the conclusion of the meeting privately. And so I would suggest.
And I'm sorry to cry, but I wear my heart on my outside, and I really am not a me. I didn't want ever to come this far. But I don't know what else. I really don't know what else to do. I'm at a loss. I sold my house, I downsized, and I moved here, thinking, oh, I'm moving to an awesome place, and I can have my dog. I mean, most of you have seen my dog. She's a very large dog. But she's my, you know, and it's not, I'm right in the middle. My kids live in the city, and it's easy for me to get to places. And everywhere I work is right here. And I really don't know what else to do, and I'm looking for some help. That's all.
Well, I'm hopeful that we can offer you some kind of guidance. So if you could hang around at the end of the meeting, we'll talk.
And I apologize for...
No. You have the right to come before council, and I'm glad that you came with this issue. Let's do... is there any other public comment? Action item 6A. Mr. Metrick, could you give us a little... background on for the public in terms of how we've gotten to this point and
what
we've accomplished this evening.
Sorry. Narberth Borough has been recruiting for the position of Chief of Police since December of 2017, that was last year. And we contracted with the Pennsylvania Police Chiefs Association to assist the borough with that recruitment effort. And through their network contacts and our own advertising venues. We got dozens of well-qualified candidates to review. And through that process, the interviews that took place last week, we have a recommendation council to fill the position of to work towards filling the position of chief of police from this pool of candidates.
Okay. Would someone like to make a motion?
I'll make a motion. Thank you. Sorry, President.
Yes.
I'll make a motion for conditional offer of employment to candidate of chief of police for Norman Police Department.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Thank you. Is there any discussion amongst council? I will note that council met in executive session prior to this meeting to discuss confidential personnel matters related to this conditional offer of employment. All in favor of allowing the borough manager to make this conditional offer of employment, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? None? Unanimous. Thank you. Now we can move to a presentation from our architects, or from our facilities assistants. They are architects.
Good evening.
Maybe council members would like to retire to the gallery.
Oh, so I'm tired of Florida. So yes. Sean, before I launch in, do you have any introductory comments?
I don't, other than to say this process started, I think, back in September, October of last year. We went through a procurement effort to bring in a team of professionals to look at all the borough's grounds and buildings that it owns, to look at what state of repair or disrepair it's in, what it's going to cost to maintain those systems so that we can plan more effectively through our capital plan, which will be a major push that we're going to be making in the next 60 days or so. And KCBA Architects came out on top through that process, and I'm really pleased with the work that they've been able to do for us so far. And Ed has been their point person working with Happy. I can't say enough good things about Ed and KCBA Architects. It's been a good experience so far.
Thank you very much. Good evening, everyone. Name again is Ed Mangle, KCBA. As Sean noted, it's not a fully baked cake at this point. The goal is to support the generation of options and build consensus around them with the staff and council as we're working towards kind of converging the efforts of the study, the results, and the proposals, along with the budget, capital improvement budget that Sean's been putting together. So we anticipate pulling the cake out of the oven, to further the metaphor, sometime in May, probably third week in May. And I'll be back in front of you at some point, maybe even at that same meeting, to give the final presentation and proposal. We'll probably be meeting with the property committee at least once or twice prior to that as well, as we're starting to flesh things out and bring it home. So I'd like to start off with, as Sean mentioned, we had a team of folks come in, two consulting engineers, mechanical and electrical, plumbing, and our civil engineer review group. Two folks took a look at all the facilities as well, myself. Went through all the buildings and the site amenities that the borough has. It's a very comprehensive list. If I go too fast through anything, just tell me to go back. There's 52 slides here. Most of them are pretty pictures at the end. So most of the front end of this is setting up how the process ran, just to get everybody on the same level of information. As Sean mentioned, we had met with some outgoing and incoming council folks at one point, so some of this may be a repeat, but I think it's important that everybody has a good foundation moving forward. So the facilities evaluation, we considered, as Sean said, a really comprehensive look at all the facilities. One of the goals is to develop a really nice, clear, usable tool for Sean and Matt to use as time goes on, as far as repairs and maintenance. We developed that list, we assigned priorities to it, we work with the staff to develop those priorities and assign costs. And in some cases, we're going to look to bundle some of those into some small projects that can be done in, at one time, so you can get the most bang for your buck and your effort and your time. Future operations, this is a developing community. You're theoretically landlocked, but the services you provide continue to have to grow and update as time goes on. So we want to make sure we're looking forward as well. You're not trapped in a bubble of time here. And of course, we'll propose, like I said, options. And one of the big things that we'll spend some time on this evening is talking about safety. Safety for the staff, safety for the community that has to come to the facility and the borough campus here for use. So we did a really intense existing facilities analysis. We sat down with the administration, department heads. We interviewed some folks on council as well that were available at the time of this intense discussion. We leave the door open if anybody on council would like to meet. Like I said, the cake is not fully baked here, so from what you see this evening, it may spark some questions that may need more time than we have this evening. And we already kind of touched on these elements here. Here's a quick overview of all the facilities and site elements for the borough, including 201 Sabine, Sabine adjacent Sabine Park, the library at Windsor, Station Circle, that is basically some maintenance, some facility maintenance, some paving work and things like that, and of course Conway. Conway is going to be a big part of the focus of proposed work or improvements, at least in the short term, because of the safety and security and work environment improvements that we think we can execute in the short term period. So these are just the bullet points when we walk through the building. These are the things we look for: conditions of the facilities, both inside out, your mechanical systems. You have some new mechanical systems, some really ancient mechanical systems, both in the fire department and on the borough side, that we're recommending replacement on. We'll see that as we go through here. So as we did our existing facilities review, this is just an example image, but each of the buildings and facilities will have a narrative describing what we saw when we went through, things of concern, and then elements that we call issues to consider you'll see in red. Those elements are the things that we're going to gather into the spreadsheet that I alluded to, that are going to be laid out there, prioritized, and assigned a cost figure to them. So it's a nice way to go through each of the building, be able to kind of read in a narrative way with associated pictures, so you really get a good feel for what's happening in each of the facilities. And in addition, you start to get a sense of where the considerations and the recommendations are going to be in an easy to read, easy to digest format. So all this is going to be delivered in a final book format sometime in May. So that's going to have all the facts, figures, and these building narratives in it. Tonight is just showing you kind of a flavor of what's there. So as an example, here at the borough building, we just hit the main points of the building, but just wanted to highlight some of the bullets as we went through. One of the biggies is there's no secure progression into the building. You have two very open doors. One of them is actually an automatic sliding door, which is there's no vestibule airlock conditions at either of those locations as well. So from a facility standpoint, operationally, it's just not efficient to keep those spaces warm and conditioned, especially in the heart of the winter. Security cameras would greatly improve, just the ability for not just the police, but the folks that work in the building to keep an eye on things. You have a very open campus parking lot. The police vehicles aren't in an enclosed, secure area, so it would be important just as a visual deterrent and as an actual source resource to look at information if something would happen. Interior finishes, as you can see, they're kind of dated and worn. Although there have been some improvements over time, it's really in need of some sprucing up. When I came in to talk to Sean maybe a couple meetings ago, we kind of had this conversation about how the building's got really good bones, and we think there's a lot to work with here. One of the big assets, and I think one of the window people or the interiors folks that came by, they said all the natural light you get in this building and on the borough side is a huge plus. That is great resource for working with. It's something that in modern architecture, which this is not, in our new designs, we're always trying to make more use of natural light. And then when you can tie that into lighting improvements, LED replacement, light harvesting software, you can take advantage of that natural light and not use as much. You obviously have some water damage. Over time, you've replaced the roof, but the damage is still remaining. And I think that's been put on the back burner because the study and the report and the findings are coming. And rather than try to patch and paste here and there, we want to try to gather all those repairs into one cohesive project. And then there's always another ADA improvement to be made. This level was made accessible by the introduction of the elevator, the ramps out here as well, but because of the vintage of the original building, anything that you didn't touch with the most recent renovations still has issues. Graspability of railings, both inside and out, could be improved. Some door hardware and things here and there. So there are some improvements that could be made to make the facility more universally usable. Second floor of the building has a lot of nooks and crannies. It's been chopped up over time, and we got feedback from staff, but we also observed when you walk through that it's just not a really good, efficient use of the space that you have. So doing space evaluations and different layouts is a very low-cost way to try to improve the shell of the building to make it more usable. We'll have some examples of how to do that later on in the presentation. The community room, because this is a giant room and the configuration and all the heat's on the outside, it limits being able to divide it up. It's so large that you could be holding multiple things in the space at one time, so that's something that we want to take a look at as well, which we'll see shortly. The light fixtures, this type of, we call these the diffusers on the lights, these kind of square parabolics. They're of a certain vintage, and they create kind of a dim look in the space when you look up at the ceiling. Over time, they get dirty and they get very hard to clean. So one of the recommendations that we're going to offer is a lighting replacement and upgrade package, moving to LEDs, which is much more efficient and with better diffusers. You have a lot of dated infrastructure, some electrical panels, fire devices that need replacement. They're past their prime. In some cases, some of the electrical panels and even the rooftop equipment and the delivery method for your HVAC, they don't make the parts anymore. So at some point, they're going to croak, and you're going to be kind of duct taping, which we're probably doing currently to keep things operating. So it's something we want to get ahead of as well. Just an anecdotal picture of extension cords under desks. Over time, more and more power and charging, and I know the fire department, the police department, they carry more and more technology on them whether it's police upgrading body cams and their walkie-talkies, flashlights, everything needs to get plugged in. And the facility just doesn't have what it needs to be able to keep all those things moving. So it's just a visual representation of kind of a dated infrastructure. This is a really boring sheet, but this was the kind of ground point for us. So we went through the building, we created a three-dimensional model of the building, took the spaces off that you have, and we built from that. We used that as a model to say, okay, this space is undersized, the police side of the building is undersized for the function, and then we can make recommended target improvements or recommended size enlargements for certain spaces. And we use that when we go through and make these options, we put these options together. So you can see a nice overall of the site here. While it looks nice and clean and pretty here in the three-dimensional model, sometimes the reality is a little bit different, which we can talk about. The organization of the building, it's tight and it's compact by nature of where it's built. And within the community, you are limited by your space. So we're going to try to make the most use of what you currently have in this proposed option. So there's existing conditions. For clarity's sake, we didn't put all the stacks and things in the space. And then an aerial of 201. It is a huge property. It has a lot of uses currently. We went through all of these. We went actually back to 201 twice because it was an expansive review because of the size of it. We went back twice, not because of the issue. It was just a lot of ground to cover in one day. But it is a great amenity for the borough to own. The park, the size of the parking lot, it offers a lot of potential for future use should you go down that road. That's a big picture discussion item that I'm sure you'll be going through in the not too distant future. One of the things that at 201 that I think everybody's well aware of is the roof condition there. And at the behest of Pannoni Engineers, who did a study for you before we came on, an investigation of the condition and moisture level underneath the roofing was done. And the areas in yellow, this is the three-story school portion of the building. That area needs the insulation under the roofing is so moist that any work that we do on the perimeter of the roof, which needs work, this will kind of be a hand-in-hand replacement. You don't want to correct one piece and leave another problem in place. That's probably part of what caused the degradation of the soffit conditions was moisture penetrating and not having anywhere to go. So we have recommendations on how to fix that, and we're assigning costs to that are going to show up in that capital budget plan moving forward. So you'll be able to make some decisions. Do you invest the money in a larger project there if you're going to continue operating all the multiple tenants out of that site? So like I said, a lot of the discussion tonight is going to center around this campus only because of the potential phasing of projects moving forward. Each of the facilities needs some work, but because you have such heavy function here between the police, the borough offices, the fire department, you have community coming into this building as well, there does need to be some focus here. So looking first at I'll zoom in shortly, but the parking lot right now is pretty inefficiently laid out. There's very little site lighting out there for evenings. If you have a big meeting and people are forced to park out there, it is a concern just relative to safety. Current code requires at least a couple 2.5 foot candles out there in that parking lot. You only have that under one or two lights unless you have basketball. Public works yard, Public Works does a lot of different things, and they tend to need supplies and materials, and just over time, they've collected a lot of stuff, which you walk back there and it becomes readily apparent. So the Public Works yard, which is securable, is great, but there's so much stuff in there that it makes operations very difficult and inefficient at times. And it's also overflown into the adjacent area where you could be making better use of that space and maybe taking some of the pressure out of that yard area currently. So we'll have some recommendations for that as well. So these asterisks represent your entry points and where you think needs to be a secure point of entry for safe function of the building. This kind of connecting corridor is kind of free flowing and open. Anybody can come in, they can go right up the stairs, they don't have to check in at the office. So that is one of the first things we look at. We do a lot of schools and municipal buildings, and as you can imagine, there's a lot of heightened concern right now about making sure the people that work in the building are safe, as well as the people coming to the building can feel safe once they're in. So that's one of the highlighted items that we're going to talk about tonight. So one of the things that we took a look at was creating actual vestibule spaces at each of these points. We understand that the fire company has